Wednesday on Home and Family, Carrie Ann Inaba from Dancing with the Stars is here, and musician George Thorogood is performing. Welcome back, everybody. We are back with dermatologist Dr. Sonia Batra discussing causes and treatment for a very common skin issue called melasma. Welcome, doctor.
Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
So we're all on the same page. Melasma is...
It's a really common, over 30 million people worldwide are affected by it. It's discolored patches that commonly occur on the face. So many women experience it during pregnancy. It's sometimes even called the mask of pregnancy.
But it's not just women.
No,
I was gonna say,
no,
are
it's
men
actually.
Because I can step out if you
like. You're kind of outnumbered here.
It's the minority, but about 10% of men experience melasma too. And that's because it's caused by hormones, genetic predisposition, and then, of course, sun exposure, ultraviolet light.
So I know you actually had melasma during pregnancy, didn't you?
I did, and it was the biggest injustice.
I mean, you're like, wait a minute, how is this happening?
I knew exactly what was happening. It was my first pregnancy, and with those elevated hormones, and I had a genetic predisposition. I live here in Los Angeles, so tremendous ultraviolet.
Did you judge yourself?
So I did. I was like, how can this be? I know what this is.
Yeah. So, but it's interesting you said during your first pregnancy, because it doesn't always happen during every, if it's going to happen in one, doesn't mean it's going to happen in the next.
Completely true. And although I will say that people who are predisposed to melasma, it often comes back. So you don't even have to be pregnant. You can be on a birth control.
Larissa,
I was going to say, let's talk, turn to the couch.
Yeah, I've had it for years, and it drives me insane. And a lot of people, when I was in the commercial break talking about it, Maria's like, where? I don't even like pointing it out, because then I feel like you'll notice it. And I put a lot of coverage on, and I use like color correcting stuff to try to minimize it. But even so, when I look in the mirror, it's all I see. And it drives me insane.
Did you have it as well?
I didn't. I just have pregnancy.
A lot of other things.
I just have the breakouts and the normal things like that. But no, I didn't. But I am crazy with sunscreen and hats and things like that. So I don't know. But I don't think it's in my genes.
But also you're fair skinned, like you said.
Exactly. So much more common in more olive toned Mediterranean skin types, but you can have it with fair skin.
Okay.
For sure. I mean, very fortunate that you don't. but like you said, a lot of it is about what you're using. So we always talk about mineral based sunscreens, really sticking with that zinc sunscreen that's going to shield and physically block your skin. It's so important because melasma really does require maintenance.
So is that our first line of defense, or how do we treat it then once we
First line of defense is prevention. Like you said, so your broad brimmed hat, which you already mentioned, so key. Paige, I love that you're wearing a hat.
I was even indoors.
Even indoors. Yeah. A mineral-based sunscreen, that's the preventive aspect. If you are experiencing it while you're pregnant, there are non-hydroquinone, very safe fading agents that kind of help your body prevent that lay down of pigment. But then once you've actually delivered, you've weaned your baby, you have more chemical options as well, hydroquinone being the most common.
Well, if those creams don't work, because sometimes they don't, you have some other measures that we could take. What do you recommend to your patients? And it's not always the same, like you said, you don't know.
Absolutely, and that's why it's really important to see a dermatologist or see a skincare professional, because many times, especially in olive-toned skins, the treatments can actually make you worse if they're not tailored.
That's why I looked into lasers and the different things, and the, you know, I read reviews, and a lot of the people said that it actually exacerbated the problem. So I haven't turned to any of that. I've used creams, nothing seems to work that well, and it comes back.
I was going to say, does it stay or does it go away and comes back?
It can go away and come back. So that's the key thing. So after the creams, kind of the next level up, some people do need more interventions. What I did after my first pregnancy was a chemical peel. And so that's where you're actually coming into either doctor's office, plastic surgeon's office, dermatologist. This is me actually applying a chemical peel to one of my patients. And what they do is they're products that you put on top of the skin, and you'll often leave the office even with it on, and it really sloughs that outer layer.
To hear chemical peel, though, sounds a little scary.
It does. Yeah. And so that's why you really need to be in trained hands.
Okay.
And like I said, it can sometimes, especially if someone doesn't know what they're doing and they're using something way too strong or that doesn't suit your skin type, it could even strip your background color.
Oh, boy.
It could make your discoloration worse.
You have to be very careful.
So be very careful, but there are chemical peels that actually are very effective.
How many times would you have to do it before you'd see a result?
It depends. So you should see an improvement each time you do some form of treatment, and it should get better, but you may need, depending on how dark the discoloration is, anywhere to up to 3 or 4 treatments, usually staggered about 1 month apart.
Sure. A quick question for you. Are all dark spots considered melasma, or is it a different thing?
No, that's actually a great question, because pigmentary concerns are the most common cosmetic concern worldwide, but they're not all melasma. Many of us, like me, if I get even a pimple or a scratch, it discolors and it turns dark brown. And that's actually not true melasma. That's from the inflammation. So that's post-inflammatory pigment change.
So what if the chemical peel isn't enough?
So if it's not enough, thankfully we have bigger guns too, like lasers, which are tools that can be applied to really strip the pigment. This is me in my office. Yeah, it sounds a little like a machine gun, but this is a newer laser. It's called the PicoSure. And the reason I like this laser is because it's one of the safest in pigmented or olive toned skin. It's a much shorter pulse width. It's basically a trillionth of a second, and it's breaking apart and shattering those pigment cells under the surface of the skin. So we usually numb people before we do it. So it does otherwise feel kind of like a very hot snap of a rubber band.
And how many treatments of laser would you have to...
So again, I'm really conservative. I usually recommend anywhere from 3 to 5 treatments about 1 month apart. And that's because if you're doing it conservatively and safely, each time you do any one of these treatments, especially a laser, you should get maybe 20 to 30% improvement. You should be going for gradual lightening.
Yeah.
Too aggressive treatment could strip your background pigment, or if you're inflammation prone, it can even hyperpigment.
If you don't believe this works, take a look at the before and after. And this is after a session of 3.
So interestingly, this is actually by chance after a session of 1, but I don't think that's typical.
Oh, okay.
I think that usually I tell my patients expect to do about 3 to 5.
She just responded really well.
She just happens to be a really good responder. This, on the other hand, is more of after a 5 treatment session or 4.
But it's getting better. It is getting a whole lot better.
Yeah, so you can see. And this is the really common distribution. I know, Larissa, you mentioned you get it on your upper lip. This is a great example of upper lip, lateral cheeks. That's where we see it, often called the mask of pregnancy.
Does it only happen on your face? Can you get it on your arm or your leg or anywhere else?
It's not as common off the face, and often in that case we would consider it more to be like a sun damage or hyperpigmentation, as opposed to a true melasma, which tends to be more of that genetic hormonal and sun damage kind of combination.
Good.
Only happens on the face.
Wow. Yeah, it's only the most visible, most
I'm glad I'm in the minority.
You know what? The doctor is helping us put our best face forward.
So thank you. Wonderful. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Putting her best tray table forward.
Yes. That's right. Wearing my hat because I got started in the sun earlier. Come on back. I'll show you how to make a table for your couch.